Hello. In this video, we will explore the use of OpenAI's Text Embedding API and Google's Cloud Vertex AI Matching Engine to create a content recommendation system that combines the strengths of both OpenAI and Google Cloud. We will utilize OpenAI's innovation in large language models with the Text Embedding API while leveraging the hyperscale and cloud service innovations of Google Cloud with its matching engine. This engine is a serverless and relatively turnkey service for vector similarity, which forms the foundation of our content recommendation system. We will set up the system and call these APIs using a Jupyter notebook. We'll run the notebook on Vertex AI Workbench within Google Cloud for ease of use and authentication. However, feel free to use your own Jupyter environment of choice. Importantly, when setting up the Workbench notebook, we need to use a custom service account to ensure we have the required permissions to work with the AI systems in Vertex AI. We will demonstrate using the editor role to grant those permissions, along with some others. However, you might want to adjust the scope for your specific use case, especially in production. It's also worth mentioning that a key aspect of the Vertex AI matching engine is networking. We will need a dedicated VPC with service network peering in order to make the gRPC calls to an internal API endpoint. This is how we can consume the matching engine. In this example, we will use blog posts from our softwaresim.com site as the content for our recommendation system. These blog posts are defined in markdown files, which we will use to create the vector similarity system. You can experiment with your own content, such as simple text sentences or even other content types. For instance, you could analyze video transcripts using vector similarity to understand which videos might be similar. Additionally, by creating different embeddings, you could explore content like images. With our goals established, let's discuss the networking setup for this notebook and the permission setup. Then, we'll dive into the code to utilize the OpenAI API and the Vertex AI matching engine. In the project, we'll navigate to the VPC network and see that we've set up a demo VPC. Going to the private service connection, we can confirm that the connection is established. To set up this networking, we'll run a few commands in the Cloud Shell. Although these have already been executed and will produce errors, they illustrate our intentions. The first step is to create a dedicated demo VPC for using the matching engine in Vertex AI. Next, we need to create some firewall rules to allow ICMP pings, RDP, and SSH. These are standard practices for providing access to resources within our VPC. The final networking steps involve creating an IP range and using it for VPC peering. We create a range called demo range in our demo VPC and then run a VPC service to connect with VPC peering to servicenetworking.googleapis.com using our network and range in that configuration. The crucial aspect here is that we're connecting to Google's VPCs, where the Vertex AI matching engine runs in a serverless, Google-managed manner. The matching engine is not hosted on VMs in our own VPC or projects, so we need this connection to Google's VPCs and matching engine infrastructure. Keep in mind that you'll need Compute Engine admin permissions to set up this VPC peering. To help you complete the VPC setup, we'll provide the necessary commands in the video description. The next step is setting up an IAM service account. We created one called Notebooks, which has Compute Network admin and editor permissions. If your VPC setup worked correctly, you shouldn't need the Compute Engine Network admin permission, just the editor. However, having the network admin permission can be useful for modifying the network within your notebook if needed. Finally, for the setup, we need to create a Vertex AI notebook. To do this, we use the Workbench service and a user-managed notebook. We don't need any of the TensorFlow or PyTorch machine learning libraries. Python 3 will suffice. Importantly, ensure that you run the notebook in the same region where you will deploy the matching engine. If you're following along, you haven't deployed it yet, so we'll show you where to configure this in the code. In the advanced options, make sure to use the VPC that we set up and the service account we created. For demonstration purposes, we have already created the notebook and populated it with some code, which we will now walk through. First, we need to install packages like Google Cloud Libraries, the OpenAI package, and tools for gRPC calls, as calls to our matching engine service will be made with gRPC. Restart the kernel to ensure the packages are recognized in our notebook. Next, set up some configurations. Remember to select the same region as your notebook to be able to call the matching engine endpoint. If you're following along, you'll need to insert your OpenAI API key in the appropriate cell. I've already done this in the background. Specify the VPC network and then proceed to create, prepare, and use our data. I've already created a bucket and loaded some data into it for our recommendation system. Later, we will retrieve the top four recommendations for each blog post. We specify the files in the bucket that we want to use for the matching engine system, as well as the local directory to store the files. Next, we copy the files locally and read them into memory. In your own use case, if you have an extremely large number of text files or very long files, you may not be able to read these into memory. While you can configure the size of Jupyter Notebooks on Vertex AI Workbench to have more RAM, it might not be effective or scalable. Depending on your use case, you may need to adjust the approach to use data more effectively or incrementally. However, in our case, we have sufficient memory, so we can proceed. There's a lot happening in the next cell. We call the OpenAI API to obtain text embeddings, but only if the number of tokens is within our limit. The OpenAI API supports to about 8,000 tokens, and we have one blog post that exceeds this limit. As a result, we will not be able to get results for that post, and we'll use a none value instead. Note that we're using a GPT-2 tokenizer to closely match the tokenization that OpenAI employs for the embedding API. Alternatively, you could use the tick token library to count tokens, but this requires Python 3.8. In our case, we've opted for a different tokenizer for token counting. We obtained the max tokens information from OpenAI's documentation on their embeddings. As of the time of this video, the max input tokens is 8,191, and the go-to model for almost anything is the ADA-002 Generation 2 model. With that, we're essentially generating a data frame with our embeddings and making API calls for each of our blog posts. Let's go ahead and run that. It looks like we need to set our OpenAI API token, so I will do that off camera and then return to run the cell again. Now, if we run that command with the OpenAI API token, we'll be able to get the data set. We're going to drop any rows that don't have the embedding column because their token count was too long, and then export the content to a CSV file. If we open up the output, we'll see the text content, which has some metadata at the top of the markdown file and the actual text content for the post underneath it. We also have the file name for that blog post and the text embedding, which is just going to be an array of real numbers. Referring back to the OpenAI API, we know that we'll get 1,536 real valued numbers in our embedding vector. Let's move right along and start to prepare the data in the format needed for the matching engine, where we'll be deploying the service and generating recommendations from it. We need to create a JSON file that is line delimited for each blog post. If we inspect the posts file using a terminal, we can see the format. Each JSON line, which has been expanded for visibility, has an ID, a string, and the embedding vector. We could include additional options, but fundamentally, that's all we need, just an ID and embedding per blog post. This JSON file is rather large, about 2.2 megabytes, which is considerable for a JSON file. Importantly, we're also uploading it to Google Cloud Storage so that we can reference it when creating our indexes and Vertex AI assets. There are two main ways we can use the Vertex AI matching engine: approximate nearest neighbor and brute force. Approximate nearest neighbor is better for many production tasks, as it is faster and handles large embedding counts effectively. On the other hand, brute force is better when working with lower volumes of data or during development and experimentation. The additional latency and processing associated with the brute force method is acceptable in certain production applications, such as our blog post recommendation system, which deals with a few dozen embeddings, each about 1,500 values long. We will demonstrate the brute force approach in the code. Note that the process is quite similar if you use approximate nearest neighbor with just a small change in some functions. We will be using the cosine distance measurement type, which works better when dealing with content of different lengths. We want to focus on the conceptual differences and similarities between blog posts, irrespective of their lengths. The dimensions value, which might not be obvious to those new to vector similarity systems, is simply the length of our embedding vector. This will be the same across all text embeddings and is determined by the embedding used with OpenAI's second generation ADA model, 1536 dimensions in this case. The index creation can take some time, typically about 30 minutes. All right, our index has been created. The brute force index. We won't create an approximate nearest neighbor index in parallel since this index works well for our dataset size and showcases the concepts nicely. However, we should take a look at the Cloud Console and the Matching Engine page to see the index we created. Now, this is effectively an index in a logical sense, but it's not yet deployed. We need to deploy this index to our index endpoint. Let's do that step here. We'll call the deployed index ID posts brute force deployed. Again, this step is going to take about 30 minutes, so we'll see you in just a moment. It's possible in this work that we'll get a timeout exception if the deployment takes more than about 15 minutes. So we can check our index and see if it has been deployed. The deployment is still in progress, so we'll give it just a couple more minutes. With that additional couple of minutes, we now have our index deployed to this endpoint. Precisely because of this potential timeout issue, we've got some code here where we can get the endpoint despite the timeout. We could programmatically get this, but just for a simpler approach, we'll grab the ID directly. And now we'll see the post brute force deployed endpoint and some information around that endpoint. Now that we've created the index, created the endpoint, and deployed to the endpoint, we can now run our live vector similarity matches. This code here gives us a sanity check that our new endpoint is accessible from this notebook. The aforementioned VPC setup and identity access permissions enable us to hit this. So check to make sure that you have that all set up, and then we can run some example recommendations. For example, we'll grab random blog posts here and find the nearest neighbors to them. So we'll do 4 nearest neighbors and then print those out here. In this case, we're running checks against the best programming languages for statistics, which is the 35th post, and checking what's similar. Unsurprisingly, when it looks through that list, it sees the same blog post and notes that it's extremely similar, so that comes up as the first recommendation. Now, of course, for new blog posts, when we're running this, we won't already have that post in the dataset, so we won't be getting that first result. But that's actually a nice sanity check for us to make sure that the similarity matching is working well. Beyond that, we've got a couple of recommended posts around programming languages for stochastic modeling, Rust and Python, and then a software design and UML diagram post. Overall, these recommendations seem pretty good. We can continue to run inferences here, and these are all going to be very fast and efficient. Let's just grab another random post, for example, and run the inference on that. Again, we see the closest match for the post is the post itself in the list, but then we see some other recommended posts. As another example, this Introduction to Discrete Time Simulation is close to the Discrete Event Simulation Introduction post, the Continuous Time Simulation Introduction post, and a post which talks about the different modeling methodologies, including continuous time, discrete event, and compares them. To clean this up, so you're not incurring costs if you're not going to use this matching engine endpoint long term, you can run these cleanup commands here. We hope that this demonstration gave you a better understanding of the OpenAI Text Embedding API, as well as the Vertex AI Matching Engine for how to productionize your vector similarity services. We'll keep an eye on the comment section for any questions and want to thank you for watching.